From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, Deputy Editor at JAMA. I'm joined today by Dr. Bala Venkatesh, who is a professor of intensive care at the George Institute of Global Health in Sydney, Australia. Today, we will be discussing a JAMA article titled Inhaled Sedation in the Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome, the CESAR Randomized Clinical Trial. This article was published online on March 18th, and Dr. Venkatesh wrote the accompanying editorial that was published along with this study. Welcome, Dr. Venkatesh, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Walter. It's a pleasure to be here, and I look forward to discussing the results of this trial.
So acute respiratory distress syndrome, also known as ARDS, is a serious medical condition characterized by acute hypoxemic respiratory failure. It affects approximately 10% of patients treated in intensive care units and requires mechanical ventilation and is associated with a hospital mortality rate of 30 to 40%. As background, could you briefly discuss current sedation practices for patients with ARDS?
So the patients with ARDS, as you mentioned, they are some of the sickest group of patients we see in intensive care and often have long periods of stay and long periods of ventilatory support and requirement. So they need sedation for endotracheal tube tolerance, for ventilator synchrony. Often they need paralysis and therefore they need to have sedation to go with that, and for relief of pain and discomfort. And most commonly, intravenous sedative agents are used. It's usually a combination of propofol and a benzodiazepine like midazolam, coupled with an opiate like fentanyl. Sometimes dexmedetomidine is used as an accompanying agent, but this is the most common group of sedatives used for patients with ARDS. In recent times, there has been an interest in using inhalational agents for ARDS, and I guess that's the sort of background to the trial that we're about to discuss.
Yeah, and before we go on to the trial, can you just discuss some potential adverse effects of currently used sedation medications for ARDS?
So propofol is very commonly used, as I mentioned, and it contains intralipid. Therefore, there's an obligatory lipid and a calorie load. In long-term use of propofol, there's a risk of hypertriglyceridemia and propofol infusion syndrome, which is characterized by hypotension, hemodynamic collapse, and lactic acidosis. You can also get an inflammatory stimulation with propofol. With midazolam and narcotics, there's a risk of dependence with prolonged use and, of course, some respiratory depression. And there's also a risk of delirium with the use of these agents when they emerge from the sedation.
And the study we'll be discussing investigated the use of inhaled sedation, specifically sevoflurane for ARDS. Because inhaled sedation agents are typically only administered by anesthesiologists in operating rooms, could you discuss how inhaled sedation agents are typically given, for how long, what monitoring is required, and how long-lasting are their effects?
The commonly used inhaled sedatives are agents like sevoflurane and isoflurane, commonly used in the anesthetic rooms. And a typical anesthetic lasts for, depending obviously on the surgery, lasts anywhere from 30 minutes to up to 2 to 4 hours. Of course, some can be slightly longer. And usually the anesthetic is administered through a vaporizer. And in the anesthetic rooms, they are monitored. Both the inspired and the expired concentrations can be monitored. Sometimes they use what's called a bispectral index to monitor the intensity of sedation during anesthesia. And often at the end of the anesthetic, when you turn off the vaporizer and the inhaled sedative agent, the emergence is fairly rapid and patients can be liberated from the ventilator if they've been intubated, and often it's a rapid recovery. So to summarize, it's a very short duration of a matter of hours.
In addition to its sedative properties, what are some theoretical advantages for using inhaled sedation in patients with ARDS?
Inhaled sedative agents have bronchodilatory roles, and so they have been used, certainly anecdotally, there have been many, many case reports of use in patients with severe asthma. They can also cause pulmonary vasodilatation and potentially improve VQ matching in the lungs. And they are also reported to have some anti-inflammatory properties. So certainly in animal models of ARDS, when they've compared sevoflurane and propofol, they have reported lower levels of inflammatory markers in bronchoalveolar lavage fluids with sevoflurane as compared to propofol. And so in some early trials with isoflurane, they reported certainly in 300 patients who were mechanically ventilated with isoflurane, they reported a shorter duration to extubation when they used isoflurane for sedation as compared to intravenous agents.
That leads to my next question about prior randomized trials of inhaled sedation agents in ARDS. Have there been many of them? And if so, what were their results?
ARDS specifically, there have only been very small studies, and particularly with sevoflurane, there was a pilot study conducted by the same group of investigators who led the CESAR trial, where they enrolled 50 patients, 25 into the sevoflurane group and 25 into the propofol group, and reported improved oxygenation in the sevoflurane group as compared to the propofol group. And I guess that's more of a proof of principle and to understand the planning for a phase 3 trial. The isoflurane trial that I talked about before, they enrolled a heterogeneous cohort of 300 mechanically ventilated patients. So some of them would have had ARDS. But specifically, there's been no large trial, certainly a phase 3 trial, looking at inhalation sedation and ARDS as a specific cohort.
And moving on to this current study, this trial took place in 37 French ICUs and compared the effect of inhaled sevoflurane versus propofol on clinical outcomes in 687 patients with moderate to severe ARDS, which was defined by a ratio of the partial pressure of oxygen to the fraction of inspired oxygen, or PaO2 over FiO2, of less than 150 millimeters of mercury, with a positive end expiratory pressure, or PEEP, of 8 centimeters of water or higher. Can you discuss the primary and secondary outcomes of this study?
The primary outcome of the study was days alive and free of mechanical ventilation, censored at day 28. So it's effectively looking at duration of mechanical ventilation, but treating death. People who die are assigned a score of 0. So it's a death is treated as a competing risk. So what it means is if someone were to survive the 28-day period and were to have been mechanically ventilated for 5 days and remained off a ventilator for 23 days in the 28-day period, then they would get a score of 23, as opposed to someone who's ventilated for 10 days, they would get a score of 18 because it's all censored at day 28. And that also takes into account re-intubation and re-ventilation. So if they had one episode of mechanical ventilation for 5 days in the 28-day period and then were to get re-intubated and ventilated again in the 28-day period for another 5 days, then their total duration of ventilatory support is 10 days, and therefore they would still get a days alive score of 18. It's a continuous variable, and it accounts for death as a competing risk. And so people, as I mentioned, who die will get assigned a score of 0. The key secondary outcome was survival at day 90. And that was an important patient-centered outcome. And they had a whole raft of other secondary outcome measures, which included survival at various stages leading up to day 90, and looked at an organ failure assessment, particularly renal failure and need for cardiovascular support.
And what were the results of this trial?
The key findings were that patients who were assigned to sevoflurane had fewer ventilator-free days as compared to those assigned to propofol. So they had 2 days fewer, which meant that effectively, if you were assigned to the propofol group, you are likely to get off the ventilator 2 days earlier as compared to sevoflurane. They also found that patients assigned to sevoflurane had lower survival at day 90 as compared to those who were assigned to propofol. Patients assigned to sevoflurane also had a higher incidence of acute kidney injury measured by the KDIGO classification as compared to propofol. And patients assigned to sevoflurane also had a higher need for vasopressor support over the course of the study as compared to those assigned to propofol. So in short, all the outcomes were worse in the sevoflurane group as compared to the propofol group.
This is currently the largest study of inhalational sedation in patients with ARDS. Can you describe some other strengths of this trial?
The study was very well conducted, planned and built on very good pilot data, appropriate meta-analyses work, and they had adequate statistical power. It was randomized, multi-center. It was open label by sheer necessity. It couldn't be blinded. However, the outcome assessors were blinded to the trial outcomes, and there was a pre-specified statistical analysis plan. And because sevoflurane sedation is a fairly novel intervention, and not all the participating ICUs were familiar, they had an educational package to train the staff in each of the units. The randomization was well done, as shown by the baseline comparisons were well matched in both groups, and the follow-up was very good for the course of the study. The sevoflurane exposure was for 7 days, and so that sort of maximized the possibility of exposure to the intervention. And all the other treatments for ARDS, which would use, such as prone ventilation and corticosteroids and neuromuscular blockade, were very, very similar in both groups.
And can you describe some potential concerns or weaknesses of this study?
One is the monitoring of sevoflurane concentrations. They had intended to monitor the inspired and the expired concentrations when they planned the study. But because of the COVID-19 pandemic, which sort of happened soon after commencement, they had to minimize the workload for the staff at the bedside, and therefore they used the glass scores to monitor the sedation. The sevoflurane can result in elevated fluoride concentrations in the plasma if it's administered for long periods of time, and that was not measured. Certainly they'd collected specimens for biobanking, but wasn't reported in the study. That might be the subject of a future report. Surprisingly, there were 2 instances of malignant hypothermia in the study, in the sevoflurane group. Now, malignant hypothermia is a complication seen with inhaled anesthetics, and normally the incidence is about 1 in 10,000 anesthetics. So to see 2 cases in a cohort of 346 patients is a very high number, and certainly, and that's something which stood out. There were also 5 cases of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus and renal failure, which are well-recognized side effects of sevoflurane. And of course, the other key issue is the 7-day exposure to sevoflurane. During anesthesia, it's normally a matter of hours. In the pilot trial, they exposed all the patients to a maximum of 2 days. And in the isoflurane trial, as a comparison, the exposure was up to 54 hours. So 7 days, we are looking at 168 hours of sevoflurane exposure. And that is something that has not been reported before. Whether that was indirectly contributory to the adverse outcomes is something we don't know. And of course, the other finding was that when you look at the causes of death in both groups, there was a higher proportion of patients in the sevoflurane group who had refractory shock as compared to the propofol group. And that fits with the higher need for vasopressors and the accompanying hyperlactatemia in the sevoflurane group. And you wonder if sevoflurane, in fact, contributed to a worsening circulatory state. But that's something that they have to tease out in the secondary analyses.
In your editorial, you state, these findings do not support the routine use of sevoflurane for sedation in critically ill patients with moderate to severe ARDS. Do you think that further research into inhaled sedation for patients with ARDS is warranted?
I think that's a very, very important question. There are currently two trials of isoflurane sedation which are in progress, and they will inform the discussion further. The question about had the sevoflurane been used for shorter periods of time, would that have, in people who received SIVO for, say, 2 days or 3 days, were the outcomes any different as compared to those who received for longer duration? And that is something that will come out in the secondary analyses. And it's also important that patients with ARDS sometimes, very occasionally, can get severe bronchospasm. And if that were to happen, and if they are refractory to conventional bronchodilators, and if clinicians are not able to break that episode, then often they use inhalational agents. And so under those circumstances, clinicians may look at using inhaled anesthetics even if they've got a primary diagnosis of ARDS. And that's something, again, it's a clinician decision based on individual cases. But our conclusion was that there's certainly prolonged sedation in this particular case based on a 7-day duration was not something we would recommend in ARDS.
Before closing, is there anything else you'd like to mention that we haven't previously discussed?
I just want to, firstly, of course, congratulate the authors on this very, very difficult study they've conducted. They did extremely well with a very high protocol fidelity. But it also raises the important issue that you can plan a study with very good physiological rationale. You can plan a study with solid pilot data, which supports a phase 3 trial, but it's a well-powered phase 3 trial, which brings out the full information on safety and efficacy as the authors have done. And this really informs the critical care community on the risks of using prolonged inhalation sedation in critically ill patients with ARDS.
Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us about this interesting and important topic. I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, and I've been speaking with Dr. Bala Venkatesh from the George Institute for Global Health in Sydney, Australia. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.